ओम पूर्णमदः पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते। सो वेलकम टू आवर सैटरडे मॉर्निंग सेशन। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल लेट मी विश यू वंस अगेन ए वेरी हैप्पी दिवाली एंड ए वंडरफुल न्यू ईयर एंड ए ग्रेट फेस्टिव सीजन टू ऑल ऑफ यू। नाउ वील कंटिन्यू ऑन आवर subject. In the last two sessions we talked about insensible and unintelligible. So it became clear that a part of the universe is in the manifest form which can be perceived with our sense organs. Like we can see the mountains, rivers, trees, other forms of life, humans. These are in the manifest form that are sensible. We can sense them with our sense organs. But there are certain things which are in manifest form, they are still insensible. For example, our own mind, it's manifest, we know, but it cannot be sensed with sense organs. It can be perceived only with our mind. Similarly, if we look at the vast empty space surrounding us, it's in the manifest form, but it is not sensible. We cannot sense it. We have to get two objects, for example, the moon and the sun, and we say that whatever exists in between is the empty space. So that is manifest part in two ways. One way which is sensible with our sense organs, the other part which is not sensible, but which can be perceived with our mind. So that is the manifest part. Then there is non-manifest part, which is 99.9%, which is neither sensible nor intelligible, which cannot be perceived with our sense organs, nor it could be understood with our intellect. Then there are certain riddles of the existence, like egg was born first or the chicken was born first, or a man was born first or the woman was born first. These are unintelligible questions which remain unanswered till date. So these are the riddles of our existence which we are trying to understand. Now, how does the spiritual path help us in resolving these riddles? That is the question. So today we will talk about little bit about a very fascinating what we call darshan in Hindi is called Sankhya. Now Sankhya tells us that we don't need to do anything, we just need to know, and once we know, all our darkness will disappear and we will reach the right path, because the Sankhya believes that we are already Brahman. We already have divinity. That divinity is covered with darkness because of the Trigunaj, or the cover of the Trigunaj. And therefore, we are not able to understand that we are divine ourselves. And once that darkness disappears, then that divinity automatically manifests itself. And we don't have to do anything. It's only through the knowledge that we can understand it. To tell in Sanskrit, Gyan Mark, that only through the knowledge, you remove the veil of darkness, and the knowledge appears, and you will feel that you are a manifestation of the divinity, of the divine. So this is like the darkness does not exist. It envelops a place when there is no light. As soon as the light appears, the darkness has no existence, so it disappears. So this is a very profound principle of Sankhya, in which it is said that nothing is required to be done. We just need to realize what we are. And that realization is possible through knowledge, through jnan. And that jnan will remove all the darkness and your divinity will start demonstrating itself. Of the divinity which you already are. There's nothing else to be done. Like the sun appears, the darkness disappears. This is precisely the same way the knowledge appears, the ignorance goes away, and your divinity starts demonstrating. Now this is, there is a verse in Bhagavad Gita, which is actually 16th verse of second chapter. The first part of the verse says, Nasto vidyate bhavo, na bhavo vidyate satah. That there is no existence of the untruth, no existence of darkness. The existence is only that of sat. The sat exists and asat does not exist. The asat exists only or as long as the sat has not manifested itself. So that is why Krishna said that asat ka koi astitv nahi hai aur sat har jagah vidyaman hai, uska sab jagah astitv hai. And that is what we need to understand, that the divinity inside is part of sat, which we will realize as soon as we acquire that knowledge. And the asat will disappear like the darkness disappears as soon as the sun comes. Similarly, there's another example in Upanishads which is often given. That is the example of a rope and a snake. That in the darkness, you mistake the rope as a snake and you feel scared. You have that fear. Oh, there's a snake there. But as soon as the light appears, you realize that there's no snake, it's only a rope. So you have to do nothing. You don't have to remove the snake or the rope. You simply have to put the light on. As soon as the light is on, the reality will appear on its own, and all the darkness will, all the maya or all the illusion will disappear. So this is a fundamental principle of Sankhya, in which the spiritual person tries to acquire the knowledge, and the knowledge itself will lead to removal of all darkness. That is one basic principle. Now, then if you recall, in the beginning of the third chapter, Arjuna asked this question to Krishna, that if knowledge is everything, then why are you pushing me into this, karma, which is that Bhayankar Yudh, that, big war? Why are you pushing me into that karma if knowledge is everything? So then he talks about karma. So there are two basic concepts here. One is the Sankhya, another is Yoga. Yoga is basically sadhana. It requires certain practices to be followed. Yoga feels that knowledge alone will not remove the ignorance. Knowledge is good, it is desirable, but this alone will not remove the ignorance completely, and therefore we need to do sadhana. And that sadhana is yoga, that you have to do something. Now, for example, you go to a doctor, you have some ailment in your body. You go to a doctor, the first doctor says that there is basically no ailment. You have to regulate your, food habits and your, rest and sleeping habits. So just do adjust your food and regulate your you know, sleeping habits, rest habits, your exercise, and everything will be fine. Now, that is like saying that you acquire knowledge and everything will be fine. But the people are not happy with that kind of doctor all the time. When you go to doctor, you expect some medicine. If the doctor does not give you any medicine, you feel disappointed. I've seen many people who visit a doctor and the doctor says there's no ailment, you just do this, and regulate your diet and regulate your, you know, rest and your exercise, everything will be fine, and people feel very disappointed. They want some medicine. So the second path is yoga, in which certain medicines are prescribed. And that requires you to do certain practices, certain sadhana, certain activities, you know, certain what you call tapasya, which will guide you to the path of divinity, divine. So that is the yoga or karma. You can call it karma, you can call it yoga, but this is the path on which you are supposed to do something. They said without doing anything, the knowledge will not remove the darkness on its own. That is what this path says. So we have to understand the karma in this process. What is karma? It's a very, perplex issue. What is karma? First of all, we are not going to go into, you know, greater detail, but basically, karma is an activity or action which we do, which will have consequences, which will have some response, which will have some, you know, outcome of its own. That is karma. But the karma is not one-time affair. You know, this is very interesting. One must understand this. For example, you go to an organization and you want to, you know, increase the sales of a particular product. You people sit down and work out a strategy, and that strategy is finalized. And you say, you know, we have done our work, finished. And the strategy is implemented by the people at the lower level. The execution is taking place. Our task is over. It's not like that. Karma is always work in progress. And I explain it to you with some examples. It's not one-time event. It's a continuous process, and which is not over any given time. It continues and continues and continues. It's incessantly work in progress. For example, a parents have given birth to a child. Now you think you have done your task is over, the progeny is born. It is not so. The progeny has just born, the work continues from there onwards. The firstly, in the childhood, you have to look after the child. The child have his own activities. Then the education of the child continues with that. And then, you know, variety of activities you have to perform along with the educational part. Even if you don't do that, the child has to do that. Or even if the child doesn't do education, he has to do something else, whatever he does. So that process continues. Then he gets employment, he starts living, earning. He again gets married. He has his own family. Another child is born. And the process continues. So remember this. This process started, not only started with the birth of a child, it started much before. But let us take a point where we can call it a cutoff line. Say we take a cutoff line of a child's birth. Now, it's always work in progress. It's continuing, the actions are continuing. That child will continue to have activities, and you know, it will give birth to another child, and then activities continue. And it's an incessant continuation of activities. So the karma is not one-time event. This is we must mistake most of the time, that it is one-time event and it's over. For example, you want to construct a school. you have given donation for construction of the school is constructed. Now that's not over. The starting of the school is actually the beginning of further activities. The children will come, what kind of education is imparted, what kind of teachers will come, what will be the result of the education, what will be the performance of the children, what kind of job profile they will get ultimately, the activities start coming. Each action has an incessant chain of activities which are connected and which continue infinitely in the future. So this one thing we have to understand, that the karma, which most of us believe is one-time event, is not so. It's a work in progress constantly. It continues. If I want to trace my birth, I'll have to go back in time infinitely. You will go back to Brahma and maybe even before Brahma. And after Brahma, you will say that it was Manu and Satrupa, or the Western people say that it is, Adam and Eve, from where the births started and then continued. So from Manu and Satrupa, the life continues, and the action continues. Similarly, any activity we do today, it has far-reaching repercussions. Your simple activity, for example, you have a little fight with your wife in the morning. That is a simple event which happened, but it is not an event. It will continue to have repercussions. What is your mood on the way to office? Maybe you end up hitting a car. Maybe you end up fighting with the receptionist at the office. Maybe something else happened in the office. Maybe some other events, and they will have their own repercussions. So this is one thing we have to understand, that the karma is not one-time event. It's a work in progress, and it has its variety of manifestations. So we have to be very careful when do choose our karma. Whatever karma we choose, we have to be very, very careful. So now there are two things. We have come to the spiritual path, two things. The Sankhya, which says you don't have to do anything, just acquire the knowledge, and then you will be liberated, and you will be acquiring divinity based on your knowledge. Then the yoga path of yoga or karma, it can be put together, that you have to do certain activities, but you have to choose. So these are the two different methods primarily. You can subdivide them into different. For example, some people divide between the karma yoga and the yoga itself, but that is not it's a very subtle difference, but not real difference. Really, if you look at the world, there are only two variety of paths, spiritual paths. One is the Gyan Marg, and another is the Yoga or Karma Marg. These are the two. Even Bhakti is Karma in certain sense, because though you are doing Bhakti, but you are basically doing a Karma, and you are dedicating your, yourself to the Almighty, or you are, forgetting yourself and dedicating yourself to His shelter. So this is how we look at the spiritual paths which emanate. Now, in this context, we will take a verse from Isavasya Upanishad, and we will try to understand that verse to understand the context of spirituality. Now, this verse, let me take this verse out. This is verse number 9 of Isavasya Upanishad. This reads like this. अंधंतमय प्रविश्यांति येय विद्याम उपास्ते ततो भूये इवेते तमो ऊये विद्याय ओम रता। इट बेसिकली मीन्स दैट दोज पीपुल हु आर फॉलोइंग द कर्म द पाथ ऑफ द यू नो विद्या that is what is the path of avidya. There are two things here. Let us first understand those two things, avidya and vidya. Avidya is the knowledge as per the Upanishadic language. Avidya is the knowledge of this world. Avidya is the knowledge of what has been manifested, what is visible, what is tangible, what is sensible. That knowledge is avidya. They don't call it vidya. They call it avidya. And vidya is the knowledge of the Brahman, of the Almighty, of the Supreme, of the non-manifest. That is the thing. So it says that those people who are engaged in vidya, those who are engaged into this world, and they are pursuing various worldly activities, like somebody is engaged in earning knowledge, somebody is engaged in earning wealth, somebody is engaged in, you know, acquiring a high position, somebody is engaged in some other activity, or maybe they are engaged in what we call philanthropic activities, whatever. Those people who are engaged in this world, they are going in the path of darkness. वो अंधकार में जा रहे हैं. Those people are going to the path of darkness. But what the Upanishad says further down is even more surprising. That those people who are following the path of Vidya, who are pursuing to know the divine and the non-manifest, they are going even in the darker area. They are going in the greater andhkar, greater darkness. Now, why it is so? This has to be very, has to be understood very properly. In case of vidya, that is the knowledge of this world, which we acquire, which we follow in our day-to-day life, if we do it with the feeling of that I am the doer, then it comes out of your ahankar, out of your ego. As long as we have that ego, as long as we have that feeling that I am the doer, then you are in darkness. That is what it means. The path of avidya remains or leads you to darkness so long as you remain the doer, or you pretend to be the doer, or you feel that you are the one who is responsible for these activities. So that is the path of avidya. Then the vidya, the path of vidya, that you are pursuing the spiritual knowledge to understand the non-manifest, to understand the supreme power. But in that path, you leave the world, you abandon the world, you go to forest or Himalayas, and you start doing your so-called tapasya and to acquire the knowledge. These people remain in greater darkness because they not only pretend to follow the spiritual path, but at the same time they follow that they are pursuing the path of knowledge. That feeling of that I am the doer and I am acquiring knowledge and I have better knowledge than the people in the world, and I am surpassed those, worldly knowledge, that actually leads to greater darkness. So this verse of Isavasya Upanishad is very, very much misunderstood in many occasions. But this verse is actually the crux of spirituality. The path which you follow, whether you follow the path of avidya, whether you follow the path of vidya, firstly you have to get rid of the doer, that I am not the doer. And then first you have to understand this world. Then the second part of this verse says that first you acquire avidya, you understand this world, and then you follow the path of vidya, then you understand the non-manifest, and through that process you transcend into the Almighty. So this is one of the very fundamental verses which we need to understand properly in the spiritual path, in the sense of sensible, in the sense of insensible, in the sense of intelligible, in the sense of unintelligible. We come to the two positions, that is the knowledge, the path of knowledge, the path of yoga or karma, and that has been further explained in Upanishad in the form of avidya and vidya. Avidya is the knowledge of this world, things which are manifest, all that knowledge. If we acquire that knowledge with the feeling of ahankar, with the feeling of ego, with that I am the doer, then you are following the path of darkness. Therefore, we have to acquire the knowledge of this world after abandoning as karta, after abandoning as doer. That you are not the doer, things are happening. As I explained, the karma which you initiate has an infinite line in the future, and it had an infinite line in the past. And therefore, you are only a very small little fragment of that entire infinite chain. But the chain has been triggered at some place, and that trigger continues and continues and continues. It never ends, because it has ripples and ripples and ripples. Like the ripples in the ocean, they end up finally to the shore, but they don't end up there. Then they again continue to come back to the ocean. The water from the shore again comes back to the ocean, and then again new ripples start. Similarly, the actions we do, they don't end anywhere. They keep continuing. There's always work in process, there work in progress. There are ripples and ripples which are created, and those ripples continue infinitely. So this verse of Isavasya Upanishad is extremely important to get rid of those ripples. If we are following the path of avidya, the ripples will disappear only when we get out of the position of a doer. That, okay, I played my little role, small little chain in the whole process, but the chain is so long and so infinite that it's insignificant. I don't matter at all. And that is why it is very important to understand that the karma we do is an infinite process. For example, you married to a particular girl. Now that marriage doesn't start in this life after you know each other. Maybe you were born because of that process, and you were supposed to get married because there was a line of karma which was started long back. That is what the Indian literature, the Hindu Shastras tell us, that Sita was born because she was supposed to get married with Rama, or so and so was born. For example, Draupadi was born out of fire, and she was supposed to get married with the five Pandavas. So that chain has already been in process somewhere. Or for example, you take the case of Dasarath. Now Dasarath was given a curse by Shravan Kumar's parents that you will die in the vyog or in the shock of your son's departure. Now, the son was born after that. The son was not even born when this curse was given. The father had two wives, that is Kekai was actually married later on. Before that, the two wives had not given any son, any daughter to the king. And therefore, the king of Ayodhya was perplexed that I don't even have an issue, and still the Shravan Kumar's parents have given me this curse that you will die in the shock of your son's departure. So, these are the things which explain that the karma is an infinite chain of process. We are only a small little dot in that entire chain. We are not the doer. And that feeling should come only then the darkness of that karma, darkness of that avidya will disappear. Otherwise, it will not disappear. Otherwise, it will continue. And then after knowing this world, you have to follow the path of knowing the non-manifest. Now, this is how the world operates. We are born as a child. Then we acquire knowledge. Then we have a family life. Through this process of family life up to the age of 40, 50, you understand this world. That is how the world has been designed. You understand this world. And then you realize the futility of this world and the activities you have done. The wealth you have acquired, the name you have acquired, the position you have acquired, you realize they don't matter at all. At the time of death, you may have traveled around the world, but you forget the names of the people, you forget the names of the town, you don't even know where you were born, you don't remember who, your relatives are. You forget all that. So what is the meaning of all that? Then you start behaving like a child. You are not even able to control when you are going to urinate or when you are going to get up and all that. That's what happens in old age. So when you realize all these things happening around you, you feel whatever I have earned is useless. This world's knowledge is or the activities which I performed in this world has no meaning. So this realization comes only when you cross a particular stage in life. And that stage I put around 45, 50 years of age, when you have experienced this world and then you feel vacuum. This is what I felt in the West, in Europe and in America, where I experienced this feeling that after 45, 50 years of age, those people have a vacuum in their life. They have gone and eaten in the best restaurants in the world. They have used the best clothing they can have. They have a palatial house and, well equipped with all kinds of amenities like swimming pool and gym or whatever you have. They have traveled around the world, but then they feel a vacuum. There's nothing now in their life they can do. So that vacuum comes after experiencing this world. And this vacuum must come. Without that vacuum, you cannot launch yourself into the spiritual path. So that is why this verse from Isavasya Upanishad is very important. That you have to first acquire avidya. You have to acquire the knowledge of this world. Then you realize the futility of that world, whatever you have done. And then you move towards new direction, that is the direction of vidya. And in that direction, you will then move the spiritual path, provided you believe that you are the doer. You should abandon that you are the doer. And that you can abandon only when you realize that infinite chain of karma. You feel that, I am a great person. I did this in the world. But all these things have been happening before I was born, and this will continue to happen after I have departed from this world. And why, how I have come into this world, because of that chain I have come into this world. It is not my great achievement or my parents' contribution. It's a chain which has led me to come here in this world. So these things, these three things are extremely important to lead the spiritual path towards non-manifest, towards understanding the divine, towards understanding the Almighty, which is already seated in yourself. So I believe that neither the Sankhya alone nor the path of yoga alone can lead you to liberation, or what you call moksha. I think it's the combination of the two which will lead you there. The combination is that you must experience this world, you must experience avidya, and then understand the futility of that avidya, understand the futility of this world, and then slowly, slowly, you move into the new path, the path of understanding the non-manifest. The non-manifest is what Krishna said in verse number 16 of chapter 2, that non-manifest, that Sat, which exists everywhere, which nowhere, that there's no place in this universe where it does not exist. And Asat, it exists, but it has no existence of its own. It exists so long as the Sat does not manifest itself. That's it. Like, for example, you have a case of murder. Now somebody has filed a false petition against, say, XYZ. Now that person did not commit the murder, but he's accused. He's accused as long as the truth does not come out. Once the truth come out, the accused will be freed, because he didn't commit the murder. There was somebody else who committed the murder. The truth will come out, and the lie will disappear. But the lie exists as long as the truth does not come out. The darkness exists as long as the sunlight does not come out. So that is how the combination of a jnana stage, as long as the jnana does not come out, as long as the truth does not come out, the darkness stage. And that we must realize. And therefore, we have to look for the truth. We have to guide our life in the path of truth. Because that darkness which we have in ourselves will not disappear unless the truth comes out. And the truth comes out through these two methods. First, you have to understand this world. You understand avidya. Understand the futility of this world. That this world is important, but it doesn't lead you anywhere. At the fag end of your life, you are exactly where when you were a small little child. Exactly there. Ending up there. So it doesn't lead you far enough. That futility we should realize, and then we should leave the path, which is to understand the non-manifest, which is perpetually in existence in this entire universe everywhere. And that is called Vidya in the Sanskrit verse, but also in Upanishads. Avidya, Vidya, and karma ki gati, the pravaha, the flow of karma, the flow of action. These three things are extremely important to follow the spirituality in our day-to-day life, after understanding the sensible, the insensible, the intelligible, and the unintelligible. So I think we will conclude this session here, and we will basically understand that the spiritual path is possible only after understanding these four or five things. the sensible, the insensible, the intelligible, unintelligible, then the flow of the karma, then avidya and vidya, and then we can actually lead a spiritual life if we understand these things in their proper perspective. So thank you very much. I think we'll stop here. You have any questions, please let me know.